Hey everybody, welcome to Let's Just Dance Discord. It's a fucking thing. I'm producing the show now. I kicked Rimchi out. He quit. Fuck. We're all fucked. Okay. With me is Sarah's watching.
Yeah, I'm here.
Yeah, Rimchi quit. He's done.
Questions could be asked as to why, but...
It's because I called in the F slur.
No, I mean, questions could be asked as to why I'm still here.
Oh, you have nothing else to do. It's Friday night.
I mean, yeah, you're right.
Yeah. So, since Rimchi's not here, we are just going to watch V for Vendetta. And lose our channel.
No, we are not going to do that.
Oh, come on.
No.
Come on, it's 5th of November.
I don't care.
You know how it goes? Remember the 5th of November? Yeah.
Yeah, because Guy Fawkes was a fucking idiot that thought that he could take down all of Parliament by himself.
Yeah. Were you saying no to V for Vendetta because you don't like the movie, or were you saying that because you don't want us to lose our channel?
I'd prefer not to lose the channel. To be honest, I haven't seen V for Vendetta in a very long time.
No. I haven't seen it
Hugo
since...
Hugo Weaving is good, isn't it?
Yeah, I haven't seen it since, like, 2010.
Well, we've got ourselves a Mickey and a Canuck.
Hey, Mickey. Hey, Canuck.
Well, that's the question, though, is I don't know if you can stream it on Prime or not.
Yeah, and Mickey, it's like a 2.5 hour long movie. It's not.
I was going to say, I'm pretty sure it's longer than the runtime of the show.
Yeah, I'm just joking around. Rimchi didn't actually quit. He's just out fishing.
Yeah. Like fishing is an activity I never understood.
I get it. I'll go fishing with a buddy.
Just sitting around
enjoying the outdoors.
I think it's boring
anything.
As piss.
Yeah, but I mean, it's like hiking minus the exercise.
Then again, all the times I've ever gone fishing, it's been, like, really shitty fishing locations.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, you gotta go somewhere cool.
It's just like, oh yeah, we're gonna go and fish at this place, mainly because it's really dirt fucking cheap.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm also not a huge fan of fish as a food.
So, I like fish. I like the fish.
I like a lot of shellfish.
Oh, don't get me started on shellfish. Oh my god.
Why? Are you shellfish?
Huh?
Are you shellfish?
No, I'm not shellfish. No. I know what you did there.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so, also, since she's not here, feel free to hop in the waiting room, anybody and everybody.
Oh, you're allergic to fish? Mickey, that's terrible.
Yeah, I like some fish, but, like... And shellfish, and then,
Yeah, if I ever developed a shellfish allergy, I would probably cry.
I'd die. Yeah. Yep. Tell me I can't eat Kung Pao shrimp anymore? Go fuck yourself.
It's like fucking shrimp. lobsters, crayfish, crabs, especially.
Mm-hmm. Crab. I used to go crabbing a lot when I was a kid.
Like, apparently it starts very, very early for me. When I was very, very young, my mom and dad, they went down to Florida for a little bit of a vacation. My dad worked for an airline at the time. Mm-hmm. It's defunct now. It was the airlines. Some people might actually remember it, might remember the commercial. It was American Trans Air, ATA.
Yeah.
They were primarily like a charter flight airline, and they did a lot of vacation flights. They were based here in Indianapolis. But anyway, we went down to Florida, and apparently one night they got king crab. Like, they got king crab legs. And according to both of my parents, like, little, like, one-year-old something me is basically eating it as fast as they can get it out of the shells. So my love affair started very early. I haven't had any king crab in a while. I need to rectify that soon.
Yeah. I need to start getting more comfortable with, like, public transportation or taking Ubers again so I can go out and do things.
Yeah.
Hey.
Hey, joining us, Canuck.
Yeah. What's happening, boys? We're talking about shellfish.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Fuck yeah. I'm into this.
I mean, to be fair, like, if it comes out of the water, pretty much, I'll eat it.
Yeah.
Fish, yeah. Shellfish, mollusks, clams, oysters, octopus, squid, scallops.
Yeah, no, I support this entirely.
It's like, yes, give me all of the things that swim so that I may consume them.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to send you guys the best crab fish recipe. Yeah. Here we go.
I look at things.
Oh, it's even better because it's done in song form. where will I put it? Is there no live show room in here?
Yeah.
You're in live show.
Yeah, I mean, like, the text chat.
Yeah, it's directly the waiting room.
Hold on. Sorry, I'm doing
a lot. There we go. Jeez, Jables. There we go. So how was everybody's week?
I was fine. Hey. Semi-truck crashed into a building in my neighborhood and closed down one of the busiest streets. And I almost couldn't get to the store because the entire road was closed down. And there's no, like, back roads to, like, circumnavigate it.
See, that sounds like a poor city planning decision on...
There's like
on Seattle's part.
There is a way, but I would have had to go like way out of my way because there's like a big hill, and then there's a freeway over to the side. It's all the whole fucking thing. But they did.
And how's your new job, sir?
I'm not there yet.
Oh, okay. Well, fair enough.
Yeah, the 18th is going to be the last day that I punch out of there.
That's fine.
Which, thank fucking Christ, because I'm so done.
Yes. 2 more weeks.
Less.
Yeah.
But fucking, yeah, I never want to work at a convenience store again.
That seems reasonable to me.
I've seen too many things now, things that I never wanted to see, and I cannot unsee. You know, fucking, like, just this past week, some guy comes in the comes from the bathroom, and he's like, hey, do you know that there's a bunch of, like, used needles and shit in your men's room? And I'm like, oh, god damn it.
Yeah.
So I go in there, and sure enough, there's a bunch of used needles on the floor, along with used douching bags, and I'm like, ah!
Fun.
God damn it! What the fuck? Fucking druggies use my goddamn bathroom. Like, it's gotten so bad recently that we just straight up close the restrooms from midnight to 7 a.m. Because we cannot fucking trust customers on third shift. What's with 288p stream? It's because Jables is running the show.
Yeah, Rim, she quit, so... Fuck you. Also, it's not a visual show anyways, so...
Yeah.
Does it really matter?
Sorry about that, boys.
Yeah.
I had a new hard drive installed in my laptop today, and now it just randomly restarts, so that's something I need to look at.
Yeah, you know, like, we had fucking, we found maggots underneath our chilled creamer machine, because ooh, nobody was cleaning underneath it.
Ooh.
We got popped by the health department because there was mold in our pop nozzles and in our ice machines.
Even better.
As again, no one was cleaning them. You know, we still don't have any fucking staff. And, you know, they're not going to be able to get breakfast out in the morning. Not anymore. Not after I'm gone. So I'm the only reason why there is breakfast every morning at the store right now. As soon as I leave, that's done. And to be perfectly honest, I couldn't give a shit.
Right.
Like, I'm going to teach Jennifer, who's one of the assistant managers, I'm going to teach her everything that I do, but she's not going to have the fucking time to do it. She doesn't have the time, hardly, to pull stuff out of the freezer for me to make in the morning. Let alone have to pull shit out of the freezer, make the food, run the register, and do everything fucking else that she has to do. So I am the only dedicated food service staff the store has.
And are they going to fill that position then, or...?
Fuck off, I know.
Yeah, I guess it doesn't really matter.
And the thing is, like, they hire... The way they things are now, during the fucking... All the bullshit that happened last year, my company made the expert decision to close down its training center. So every new hire that we get basically just walks into the store with no training whatsoever. And they expect us, who is we're already running a fucking skeleton crew. They expect us to train them on top of getting all of our shit done. And, well, you know it. People don't get trained. They don't know what to do. They get frustrated. They quit. Our turnover rate has been horrendous. Most of our new hires haven't lasted a week.
Ooh.
That are like, we'll hire them on, and it's like, it's their first day, and they don't show up. Or they call off. How the fuck do you call off on your first goddamn day?
I mean, I've seen weirder things, but yeah.
I only know of one exception. if somebody told you a different day, but they scheduled you in on a certain day, but they told you something different? That's about it.
Yeah. Not the case in these instances. You know, like, there's just, like, multiple little things that, like, I'm just tired of doing. Mm. Like, I'm tired of having to do the crackhead test.
Please elaborate.
Yes, please.
And for those of you who don't know, the crackhead test is if you're walking around the store and you see something in a spot that it shouldn't be. Like, for example, there's a can of cheese balls just sitting conspicuously on top of the sandwich case. It's not supposed to be there. It's just kind of sitting there. So what you do is you walk over to it, and you pull the lid off, and if the seal is intact, congratulations, it has passed the crackhead test. You can put it back on the shelf.
Ah.
Ah.
Seal is broken. Somebody was walking around munching it.
Yep. You know, just the other day I found a chip bag and a Snickers wrapper in the trash can in the men's room.
Well, I mean, like, at least they had the decency to put it in the trash.
Are you that dead set on getting out of paying for something that you'll eat it in a fucking public men's room? The fuck is wrong with you?
I mean, I can't say I've never consumed a sandwich inside of a men's room.
I have.
Life on the road gets weird sometimes.
Yeah. I have not found myself in that scenario, and I hope to never find myself in that scenario. Especially when it comes to Circle K, because at least the Circle K's around here, because the Circle K's around here are fucking shit. I don't know what it is about the fucking Midwest branch, but they do not give a shit about their stores here.
Never been to a Circle K. They're not really over here on the West Coast.
And they've just recently started a pop-up here. They look nice inside. That's something.
You know, we are now on our fourth store manager in less than a year's time.
That sounds like a problem.
Yeah, you think? Made even worse by the fact that we are the biggest fucking store in our market area. You know, we have 24 pumps. 4 of them are diesel.
Holy fuck.
We are right off of the I-65 exit. You know, see a lot of fucking traffic, and we have barely anyone to run the store at this point. Also, the store is open 24 hours. Like, our store never closes because it can't due to its location.
Mm-hmm. Well, it can. It would just probably make a lot of late night money there.
Yeah, like, we're constantly having fucking problems. Like, routinely, our pumps get gremlins. And they'll just fucking, like, oh, you know, like, you won't be able to pump gas. Or people will be able to pump gas for free. Or people will pump the gas and it charges them way more than what the listed price is.
I mean, I like
Just last month, we lost $3,000 in fuel.
Because people were getting free gas?
Yeah. Because the fucking pump system keeps fucking up.
I'd be going to that gas station all the time. That would be the only gas station I go to if it was that, like, frequent that people were getting free gas.
Like, every fucking time they come out, it's like, okay, we updated the system, we fixed it. It breaks again within a week's time. So now, like, they're just constantly monitoring it now because it fucks up so frequently. And this is not counting the times that we just straight up run out of gas because our delivery didn't come on time. Which, if you run out of gas, that causes the pumps to reset, which also fucks the system up.
Goddamn.
We've multiple times run out of CO2 entirely, which no CO2 means that you get no soda and no frosters.
No frosters. Goddamn, I don't even know what a froster is, but it sounds terrible to have not.
Froster is basically Circle K's brand of the Slurpee.
Ah, okay.
Or icy, depending on where you're at. Because both of them need the CO2 or they don't work.
Well, your time is almost over.
The soda machine still works, technically, but without the carbonation, the water to SERP ratio is fucked.
So the, let's just start getting into news.
Yes.
You want to look at the latest article I posted in the live show? Did we already talk about this or not?
You got fucking spit. Oh, I'd kill a motherfucker over that, Mickey.
Yeah.
Yeah, you spit on me, I'm coming over that fucking counter. Yeah, motherfuckers trying to get alcohol, especially when they can't, are the worst. I hate these motherfuckers so much.
Yeah, so, sir, have we talked about this one, the latest thing I posted in live show?
No.
Cool. Let's talk about it now, then.
Right, let me bring up this article. It's the Deadline article, right?
Yep.
All right. Coming to us from Deadline.com. That 70s show spinoff, That 90s Show with Kurtwood Smith and Deborah Jo Rupp, ordered by Netflix. Netflix has given a formal series green light to That 90s Show, a follow-up hit to sitcom That 70s Show. Kurtwood Smith and Deborah Jo Rupp will anchor the spinoff, reprising their respective roles as Red Foreman and Kitty Foreman. They will executive produce That 90s Show alongside its creators, That 70s Show alum Greg Mettler, who serves as showrunner, That 70s Show co-creators Bonnie Turner and Terry Turner, and their daughter Lindsay Turner. Set in Wisconsin in 1995, That 90s Show follows Leah Foreman, daughter of Eric, Topher Grace, and Donna, Leah. Laura Prepon.
Leah Foreman,
sorry. I misread it. Mm-hmm. Who is visiting her grandparents for the summer and bonds with a new generation of Point Place kids under the watchful eye of Kitty and the stern glare of Red. Sex, drugs, and rock and roll never dies, it just changes clothes. There are no deals in place with other That 70s Show cast members for the new series, but the expectations is that a number of them, including Grace, Prepon, and Ashton Kutcher, will make guest appearances reprising their roles.
That'd be cool.
Picked up for 10 episodes, That 90s Show also is executive produced by Marcy Carsey and Tom Werner under the Carsey Werner Company, which produced That 70s Show and its offshoot, That 80s Show. Does anyone even remember That 80s Show?
It had like two episodes.
Yeah.
Chatter about a new incarnation of That 70s Show has been percolating for years. Netflix has been particularly keen on the idea because of the big viewership that 70s Show drew on the platform before it left in September of 2020. The premise by Mettler, Bonnie, Terry, and Lindsay Turner started getting traction late last year, and the project quickly was set up for development at Netflix. That 70s show, which Bonnie and Terry Turner co-created with Mark Brazil, aired on Fox for 8 seasons from 1998 to 2006. Grace Prepon, Kutcher, Mila Kunis, Danny Masterson, Laura Wilmer, Valderrama, and Lisa Robin Kelly starred in the period sitcom that focused on the lives of a group of 6 teenage friends living in fictional Point Place, Wisconsin, from May 17, 1976 to December 3, 1979. Rep and Smith led the show's older cast, often stealing scenes they were in. To be fair, you know, I never really watched that 70s show all that much. Just kind of wasn't in my wheelhouse.
Yeah, I'd say go and give it another shot. Because it's based at a different time, it's kind of timeless in and of itself. I thought it was really clever how they did the whole, like, circle hangout with just, like, a smoky room, because they weren't allowed to show pot smoking.
That was pretty much my teenage years, too, so I yeah, related.
Same. Yeah.
Yeah.
Looking to capitalize on the popularity of that 70s show, for example, for expanded the franchise with that 80s show, which could not replicate that 70s show success and had a brief run from January to May 2002. That's bad.
Yep. Yeah, I think it, I think that 80s show was less successful because it just, because it was trying to do that, just capitalize on that 70s show popularity. And, they also didn't advertise it well.
Yeah. Set in 1984, ominous music intensifies. Mm-hmm. It was not a direct spinoff, and the characters and storylines from both shows never crossed. But the main characters of each series, that 70s show's Eric Foreman, Grace, and that 80s show's Corey Howard, Glenn Howerton, were first cousins.
The franchise now is... That's the other thing. They tried a spinoff instead of a sequel.
Franchise now is returning to Wisconsin for that 90s show after moving to San Diego for that 80s show. This is the second classic Carsey Werner sitcom to get a follow-up, joining Roseanne, which was revived and led to spin-off The Conners on ABC. Rep is repped by artists and representatives and managers. Wright Entertainment Smith is repped by Progressive Artists Agency and Pop Art Management. Mettler, whose most recent works include Fox's Call Me Cat, is repped by UTA and Ken Richmond. The Turners are with Gindler and Kelly. I don't know why any of that's relevant, but...
Yep. Also, The Conners... I wouldn't call that a spinoff. You killed off Roseanne with a heroin overdose.
Yeah.
Well, it wasn't heroin, it was Oxycontin, but, like...
Which
Such a mean way to kill off Roseanne. Are you fucking kidding me?
It's kind of... It's also kind of out of character for the character of Roseanne.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, obviously we know, like, the politics behind it. You know, she's not very fucking popular in Hollywood at the moment.
She made a fucking joke.
Yeah. But, you know, it pissed off enough people, and it pissed off the creative team, so they fucking threw her out, got rid of her.
Yeah.
And, yeah, the show was worse for it. Not that I really watch it.
I was a huge fan of Roseanne when I was a kid.
Oh, yeah, Roseanne was great.
Although, like, it did have... This is a lot like my family.
Although, Roseanne is... to this day infamous for having one of the single most mindfuck finales to a sitcom.
What was the finale again?
Basically, like, it turns out that, like, the last, like, 2 seasons, I think, were just Roseanne writing a book. Because, like, you find out in the finale that, like, Dan died from his heart attack at the wedding.
Yeah. And then they brought him back at the end. Yeah.
And, her daughters ended up, like, the boyfriends that they had, it was actually switched.
I need to go back and rewatch that finale.
Yeah.
But yeah, like, basically, you know, like, it ends with her, you know, like, she just kind of quietly, she's, like, sitting quietly on her couch alone at home, and she just, like, closes this book that she's finished writing. And then she does her signature laugh, and then the series is over.
No. But it was such a good show, just to show, like, Midwest white trash. Just, like, that lower middle class.
Well, yeah, you know, like, it was in a long line of, you know, like, similar sort of shows. You know, you had All in the Family, like, previous to this. And, well, Married with Children is kind of a different animal, but... Also, Married with Children is great for anybody that hasn't watched it.
Yeah, it's a clever show. I enjoy it now as, like, an adult. But as a kid, like, Roseanne, like, was more
relatable.
In tune. Yeah, more relatable for me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that opening theme music, too.
Mm-hmm.
And just, like, the panning shot around the table as they're, like, playing cards and shit.
Mm-hmm. Yep. A lot of my childhood nights were that.
Yeah. A lot of things are different now.
Yeah. I am excited to see how this 90s show goes.
Yeah.
It's been long enough, because when that 70s show came out, it's about the same time difference as the 70s to when it came out as the 90s to them making this.
Yeah.
You know, like, I'd be more, like, keen to, like, maybe look at that one. Just potentially to see, you know, like, how accurate it is. Because, you know, like, the early 90s was my childhood.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was born in 93.
Yeah, I was born in 91.
Yeah, 1976.
Old.
Hey, yep. Yeah.
Yeah, like...
Haha, Canuck's old. He's an old fuck.
The 90s was an interesting time. I miss it at times. Life seemed way simpler back then.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, yeah, everybody didn't have a phone. Everybody didn't have a fucking supercomputer in their pocket.
Yeah, I remember when the fucking first Nokias came out and they were a big deal.
Yeah, we're part of that, like, special part of millennials that got to see both the before internet and after internet.
Yeah, you know, like... You know, we grew up when, like, the main format for movies was still the VHS.
Fuck yeah. I ruined my VHS copy of Lara Croft Tomb Raider.
Nice.
Because of that one scene when she gets out of the shower and shows some side boob.
Yeah.
Ruined.
That was a fat moment for sure.
Yeah, I don't have very many VHS tapes lying around anymore.
I have Weird Al's Greatest Hits of the 90s VHS
nice.
Tape. And like, I have True Lies. I think those are the only ones I have.
I've got the special 35th anniversary VHS of King Kong versus Godzilla.
Oh, wait, no, I have one more. I have a VHS tape that has 8 hours of classic cartoons.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah, like, My mom, she's got a few VHS tapes like packed away. Cause like one thing that she did was she would record stuff off the television.
Yep.
As you did in the 90s.
And like one of those tapes is just a whole bunch of episodes of The Many Adventures of Winnie the Pooh from Disney's One Saturday Morning.
Hell yeah.
God, I love that show.
My parents right? have, my parents at one point had every episode of Star Trek The Next Generation recorded.
Ah, nice.
Yep.
Oh, that's another one I've got, is I've got a collector's box set of the original six Star Trek movies.
Nice. Yeah, my parents have that too, the one with the picture of the Enterprise.
Yeah.
When you line them all up. Yeah, my parents have that.
I need to get that back from my grandma's house.
Yeah, and then... Yeah, my parents used to, like, record all their shows. Because they'd watch them when the kids went to bed and stuff like that. You know, when we were little. And pretty much just use the VCR as a DVR. Pretty much.
Yeah.
But we can watch it anytime we want, plus the kids will be in bed, and we can fast forward through the commercials.
I need to get my original... Well, it's not like the original release, but, you know, like, I need to get my copy of Alien on VHS back from my grandma's.
Oh, fuck yeah. Just to have it?
Yeah. Well, also because, you know, like, my grandfather on my mom's side, he gave me that tape for my 12th birthday.
Oh, okay.
And he sat down, like, him and my aunt sat down with me, and I watched Alien for the first time when I was 12 years old. It scared the shit out of me.
Yep.
I couldn't sleep for weeks.
What's another good thing that I... Yeah, did you guys ever watch that that miniseries, The Tenth Kingdom?
Never saw that one.
Yeah, that one's not familiar to me.
Oh, it's like 10 hours long.
Well, I guess it makes sense. 10th Kingdom, 10-hour miniseries.
Checks out.
Yeah, I always thought it was extremely underrated, and I still have yet to meet anybody that has seen it.
Now, does anybody here remember V?
V was a little before my time.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure that, like, V came out in, like, the mid to late 80s, didn't it?
Yeah, I think so.
They did do a remake of it, like, back in the early aughts, but it wasn't good.
Nope. Nope, it was not. I was disappointed.
Yeah, let me see if I can pull this up.
I just remembered something. I have my grandma's VHS of Legend in my closet right now.
Nice.
Which, yeah, that's a movie, is about all I can say.
Jesus Christ.
Although that is the movie that established that Tim Curry is in fact Satan.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure I saw that at the drive-in theater. Because that's the thing that...
So for you guys, if you look at the stream, I have pictures of the 10th Kingdom up right now.
Okay. I'm gonna open up a browser window. Jesus.
Don't have to.
Okay, now, like... Like, the guy with, like, the weird, like, nose prosthetic, that does look familiar.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, people never...
10th Kingdom. Yeah, that one's not ringing any bells.
Does anyone remember Dinotopia?
Yes.
Yes.
That was a weird fucking series, man. Based off of children's books.
Yeah. Yeah, my friend Carl watched it all the time. Be over at his place, and that's where I got my taste for it. But it was that time period where it's like, well, I didn't get in at the start of the show. I will never be able to catch up with this.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, like,
that checks out.
Dinotopia was one of those things where it's just like, you know, it was just another in like a long line of things that came in the fallout of the first Jurassic Park movie.
Mm-hmm.
Because that movie was huge.
Mm-hmm.
That movie was straight up revolutionary.
Oh yeah,
it really like, was. Yeah.
It still looks good. It still looks good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you know why it still looks good?
Yeah, I know why.
Practical effects good. With CGI enhancement.
Yep.
Fucking everything CGI. Jurassic World, you know, like, which just came out a few years ago, looks like shit.
Yeah, and the storyline in Jurassic World is really shit when you go back and examine it.
Yeah, doesn't matter. It looks like shit right off the bat. You can't make a revolutionary movie in 1993 and then have a shitty looking one in 2017 or whenever it came out.
You know, it's like Jurassic Park 3, which is a terrible movie, but like it's the last one that looked, you know, halfway decent.
I like Jurassic Park 3 more than Lost Worlds.
I don't. I mean, like, yeah, it's nice to see Sam Neill again, but Jurassic Park 3 is not quite as meme-worthy as The Lost World.
Meme-worthy?
Yeah, it's not as fun.
Well, it's fucking Jeff Goldblum, okay? If you're gonna bring memes into it, Jeff Goldblum is a... Here's a hot take. I don't think memes would ever exist if Jeff Goldblum didn't become famous.
It's true.
Yeah, that's a good possibility.
Yeah, I fully support Jeff Goldblum.
Yeah.
He's
a memeable person.
And so, general. Between the two of them, you know, Lost World for me is always the better viewing experience. As I said, Jurassic Park 3 I just find more dull. It's harder to sit through that movie.
I completely disagree. I think it's a much easier one to sit through. Because, like,
I mean, everybody has their personal taste.
Yeah, Jurassic Park 3 was just like, hey, this kid's lost. This is a problem. Jurassic Park Lost Worlds had, like, this whole, like, this whole undertone of setting morals for, like, poaching and shit.
And, yeah, to an extent, but... And you got Seth Rogen there.
Seth Rogen?
Not Seth Rogen, fuck. Vince Vaughn. My brain...
Yeah, those are two very different people.
It happens. Although I will say that, like, in Jurassic Park 3's defense, like, one thing that I will say about, like, William H. Macy is the best part of the movie.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, sure.
Whereas, by contrast, Tia Leone is the worst part.
Yeah.
She's just insufferable at some points.
Yeah, I don't really like the characters of Jurassic Park 3, but I like the story better than Lost World.
I mean, I like the story of Lost World, just because of how batshit insane it gets towards the end.
Lost like, World does not make sense. It does not make sense to me at all.
I know it doesn't make sense. I never claimed it did. I was just getting to ready to bring up. It's like, how the fuck did the T-Rex get out of the hold, kill everybody on the boat, and then get back in the hold? How the fuck did that happen?
Because it was learning, allegedly. Lost World was just them trying to make Godzilla without making Godzilla.
No, they did that in 1998 with Roland Emmerich's attempt at the moved Godzilla franchise.
Yeah, and Matthew Broderick was great in that.
That's a lot of
the rest
that's
of
a
the
lot
movie
of fish. I will still never get that line. It's like, I don't know if it was supposed to be a joke or just an observation, but yeah.
It doesn't matter. I like it.
It's just there.
I think Matthew Broderick did a great job in that film. I think the film overall is kind of shit, but I do like to watch it for nostalgia purposes.
Have y'all seen trailers for Roland Emmerich's new movie?
No.
Okay, so for everybody that doesn't know who Roland Emmerich is, his first major claim to fame was Independence Day.
Okay,
yeah.
Fun movie.
So it's like, yeah, it's a really stupid movie.
Yeah.
But it's fun.
Yeah, I used to get Independence Day and Mars Attacks mixed up all the time when I was a kid.
Ack, ack.
Ack, ack.
But, well, there's no big guys boxing aliens in Independence Day.
Yeah.
And no, the scene where Will Smith punches an alien coming out of the spaceship doesn't count.
I don't know.
Although it is a much, it, that does have a much better one-liner.
Yeah.
I would call
Independence Day a guilty pleasure. It's a decent, fun movie.
Yeah. I said, it's stupid. The plot doesn't make any fucking sense if you really think about it, but
doesn't have to.
I love how the aliens didn't do shit. They were just like, we gotta blow it up.
Yeah, it's like this advanced civilization that traveled God knows how many thousands of light years to get to our planet has these gigantic city-sized planet destroyers.
Yeah. Also,
and they get wiped out by Jeff Goldblum in a fucking Macintosh virus? Are you serious?
Yeah, they just plugged in a floppy disk and sneezed a couple times.
It wasn't flash drive. He did put it. It was like a very early flash drive that he put into the computer.
Yeah, fine. No, Independence Day shouldn't be a guilty pleasure for you, Crab. It's a fun movie overall.
And fucking old Bill Pullman's speech is just great.
If you want to talk
pretty
about
legendary
guilty pleasures, my guilty pleasure movie is Fried Green Tomatoes.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, we all have movies that like we like and that we'll watch even though we know for a fact that they're not particularly any good. You know, I love Star Trek Generations. I recognize that it's not a good movie. I still like it, though. I like the interaction between...
You're so lucky Jeff doesn't watch this show.
I'm sorry, I just... Like, for the brief time that it's there, I like the chemistry between William Shatner and fucking Patrick Stewart.
Yeah. Oh, no, I do enjoy that. But that's not that movie.
It's not a good movie. And I can pick apart like the entire like final bad quote unquote battle between the Enterprise and that bird of prey is horseshit. There are so many things wrong with that. Mm. And I could be here for an hour explaining it. But again, you know, I like the movie overall. It's not a good movie, but it's one that I like. Star Trek Insurrection, on the other hand. Ugh. Oh, God. Anyway, I drifted off my point. So Roland Emmerich, he makes Independence Day, and that goes over really well. Then he tries to do an American Godzilla. That didn't go over very well. Then he kind of, like, was in the background just, like, making some things here and there for a while. And then he came back and made 2012, which is fucking hilarious.
You know what? That movie is a legit guilty pleasure. It's fucking trash.
It's fucking garbage.
We're gonna be frozen in this library.
No. That's a Day After Tomorrow.
Oh, fuck. They came out at, like, the same time. Another one of those things. I mixed them both up.
No, 2012 came out after Day After Tomorrow.
They came out at roughly the same time. Like...
Day After... What? Day After Tomorrow come out?
Well, I don't know. Let's get... Day After Tomorrow is 2004. Yeah.
Damn, that's actually earlier than I thought it was. Yeah, 2012 came out in 2009.
Ah, 5 years apart. Okay.
You know, back when, like, that...
You know what? I don't think I ever watched 2012.
You didn't?
Nah.
It's fucking John Cusack, like, running around trying to save his family from the end of the world.
Yeah, didn't watch it.
Like, there's a sequence in this movie where they're flying a prop plane trying to escape Yellowstone as the entire fucking park explodes, basically.
Man. As it turns out, I've been anti-John Cusack for longer than I thought. He still won't block me on Twitter. I keep bugging him about it.
But, so yeah, like, he blows up the White House and a bunch of cities in Independence Day, and then he destroys most of the planet in 2012. Now Roland Emmerich's coming out with a new movie where he's just like, you know what? Fuck it. We're just gonna drop the moon on the planet.
Perfect.
What? Okay, maybe I should go back and watch 2012.
This new movie is literally called Moonfall.
Oh, I wish
I was joking. It's like, yeah, like, the moon is falling on the planet Earth, I guess. And also there might be aliens. Not sure.
Somehow I support this.
Oh, should I pull up the trailer?
I mean, you can. They use fucking John F. Kennedy's fucking, you know, going to the moon speech in it.
Nice.
All right, we'll, yeah, I'll pull it up. Ooh, the core.
I remember the core.
That's another guilty pleasure, man. It's a fun disaster movie, I think.
That also makes no fucking sense.
What, the core? Yeah. we gotta fire bombs into the core to restart it, because it stopped, and now the birds are crashing into buildings. Yeah.
Creative license. It's a wonderful thing.
Yeah, that's fun. I'm losing track of my windows.
Watch this real quick. Lionsgate, always a good start. I choose this.
is our goal. And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? 535 years ago, fly the Atlantic. We choose to go to the moon and do the other thing. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
So, we haven't had a good disaster movie in a while, so that could be fun. Like,
this movie looks like a combination of 2012 Armageddon, Transformers, and a couple of other things. Also, the music they were using throughout was kind of similar to what they used in, like, the original Alien trailer and, like, Prometheus later.
Yeah, a lot of bwomps. You know what I'm talking about?
Still love this, like, in the year 2022, the moon will come to us.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was the first trailer that I saw when I went to go see Dune. And I'm just like, that looks so stupid.
That was Dune. I haven't watched it yet.
I like Dune. I have a few problems with it, but for the most part, I think it was a pretty good adaptation of the source material.
Yeah, I've been watching all the Dune fans argue on Twitter about it.
Well, I mean, like, you saw how me and Nick talked about it last week.
Yeah, well, kinda.
I said, you know, like, obviously, you know, like, my biggest thing was is that, like, they basically completely gloss over the spice in the movie, which is kind of a problem because it's kind of the whole reason why the planet they're on is important.
Yeah, but I could have lived without all the taxation talk in the Star Wars prequels.
Well, yeah, like, that's
everybody
a little,
forgets about that.
That's a little different, it's, though.
Yeah, no, everything that happens in Star Wars is it's based on taxes. It's fucking Boston Tea Party. That's it.
I said, you know, like, as I said, you know, like, the fact that they gloss over the spice is very confusing because, you know, like, for one, like, it's extremely relevant to the plot, especially later on. Yeah, it's like the whole reason why Arrakis is the focus of, like, the book, is because Arrakis is the only planet in the known universe where the spice can be found. And without the spice, space travel in the Dune universe is impossible.
Yeah.
Like, the entire galactic empire will completely shut down. There will be no trade. Economies will collapse without this one substance. And they don't really make that clear in the movie.
Yeah. Sorry, I was just looking through my sound effects, and there's so many I could have used earlier in the show, but I was too focused on making sure the stream's running all right. It's fucking... Rimshi, come back! Baby, come back!
Waiting for that.
That looks like the Abyss, only no. The Abyss is a much slower paced movie than its trailers led on. Not that that's necessarily a bad thing, but...
When we were talking about Dinotopia... Here, I'm just going to get some of these in now. Posthumously. When we were talking about Dinotopia...
I don't know much about dinosaurs.
Fucking perfect. Goddamn. Man, Passman is so funny.
Moonfall looks nothing like the Abyss. I actually haven't watched The Abyss in a long time.
I'm not sure if I've seen it.
Like, everybody kind of, like, remembers, you know, like, the water scene, you know, like, where the water is all, like, you know, like, serpentine and stuff, and, like, imitates chick's face.
Yeah, never watched it.
It's worth a watch.
Alright.
Also worth a watch is Critical Drinker's video Production Hell on the Abyss.
Mm-hmm.
Because the making of that movie was an absolute clusterfuck.
Are they gonna do a Production Hell about Rust when that comes out?
Don't know.
Apparently there was a live round mixed in with the blanks in the in the actual ammo boxes.
But I think his most recent production hell was on Star Trek V.
Oh.
Yeah, he did one on Apocalypse Now. He did one on Island of Dr. Moreau, the one that had Val Kilmer in it, which that one was a fucking mess. Yeah, like The Abyss, it's got some like weird elements to it, but it's mainly like a psychological thriller. Because, you know, like, you got a bunch of people trapped at the bottom of the ocean in very confined quarters, and a few of them kind of go crazy.
Yeah,
check it out.
But, like, if you're looking for, like, horror movies that are kind of in the same vein, Deep Star 6.
Yeah.
And my personal favorite, Leviathan.
Yeah.
Where you've got fucking Peter Weller and Ernie Hudson fighting like mutant sea creatures at the bottom of the ocean.
Wow. Since we've been talking about disaster films.
Being in a live show, I'm guessing.
Well, I think we should talk about this.
All right, who's covering this one?
I can do it.
All right.
An asteroid barely missed Earth last week, and no one knew it was coming. Because that's how big space is.
Yeah. Fun times.
The space rock was a cosmic visitor that no one expected. An asteroid about the size of a refrigerator shot past Earth last week, and astronomers didn't know the object existed until hours after it was gone. It was a close call from a cosmic perspective. The space rock's trajectory on October 24th carried it over Antarctica within 1,800 miles of Earth, closer than some satellites. It could have knocked out a satellite.
Yep, somebody would have lost their fucking dish TV.
Making it the third closest asteroid to approach the planet without actually hitting it, CNET reported. Oh, hey. Skull Maggot just subscribed. Oh, Mickey Ficky gifted a tier 1 sub to Skull Maggot. Thank you, Mickey.
44 gift subs on the channel.
Damn.
Nikki is the sub queen.
I don't know. I think. I think
probably
Larry
could have
might
worded that
run
better.
For her money.
Larry's not here.
Yeah, I'm just talking about. Oh, and Skull, thank you for hosting.
So, as Larry's thing is Streamlabs and Biddies, apparently.
Yeah, who knows? Whatever. Anyways, back to this. Scientists were unaware of the object, dubbed Asteroid 2021 UA1, because it approached Earth's daytime side from the direction of the sun, so the comparatively dim and small visitor went undetected until about 4 hours after passing by at its closest point, according to CNET. But with a diameter of just 6.6 feet, 2 meters, UA1 was too small to pose a threat. Even if it had struck Earth, most of its rocky body would have burned away in the atmosphere before it could hit the ground. Comets and asteroids that orbit within our cosmic neighborhood, approaching Earth within 1.3 astronomical units, 120.9 million miles, or 194.5 million kilometers, are known as near-Earth objects, NEOs. According to NASA Center for Near-Earth Object Studies, CNEOs. Arsenio Hall. All right. NASA uses telescopes on the ground and in space to find and monitor NEOs, to track their orbits and identify their size, shape, and composition, and to pinpoint potentially hazardous objects, managing these efforts through the agency's Planetary Defense Coordination Office. Isn't Space Force taking over that?
I think so. Although the tactic remains the same. Throw nukes at it. And pray.
Well, I said a long time, I think Space Force should be focused on cleaning all the trash that we leave around in our orbit.
Yeah. There's a lot of... there's a lot of decommissioned satellites that are just kind of floating aimlessly out there.
Oh, it's not even that. There's like wrenches and shit that are just spinning around the Earth.
Mm-hmm. Well, screws, capturing some of that stuff is pretty much impossible.
They just need to find a way to, like, what I really want them to do with all the trash is organize it so that we can have a ring, because that'd be pretty cool.
The trash ring. It's like we have the trash island in the Pacific.
Yeah. Let's do a trash ring around the Earth.
Like, they kind of do that in WALL-E, but it's like more like a shell.
Yeah. But it's like, what can you do with the trash? Just sort of, you can just sort of nudge it so it hits a certain orbit, or like goes and burns up in the atmosphere. Can't catch it, it's moving too fast.
And if you get in the way of it, it's like, oh, the fucking hull's been punctured, we're all gonna die now.
Yeah, that's the problem, that's why we need to organize it, at least. Little tiny rocks are a big problem when you're in orbit. Skull, it's a lot of metal objects. Can't just set it on fire.
Yeah, some fucking astronaut on the space station is like working. It's like, oh, there goes my fucking Allen wrench. Shit.
Yeah. Yeah, you need. Plus, you need oxygen for fire. There's no oxygen.
Truth.
Yep. Actually, it reminds me of a story that happened with my uncle. So, he had a science teacher, like, do an experiment when he was in school. And, the experiment centered around filling a milk jug with acetylene.
Yeah.
And then striking a match and dropping it into the jug. Now, the match goes out, because if the experiment is done properly, all the oxygen in the milk jug has been displaced by the acetylene, and therefore no oxygen can't maintain a flame. Well, my uncle was very impressed by this, I guess, so he tried to replicate it at home. Now, keep in mind, milk jugs at the time were made out of glass. So he gets his acetylene and his match. He starts filling up the milk jug. And when he thinks he's got it where he needs it to be, he lights the match and drops it in. It explodes.
Yep.
He comes staggering into the house. Like, the explosion wakes my grandfather up. He comes staggering into the house. Like, he's covered in blood. He's got glass in his face. He's got glass in his neck. My grandpa thought he'd killed himself. Yeah.
Checks out.
Like, nope, we're not gonna repeat that mistake. This is what we like to call tempting fate. Damn, that's way too young. It's a dangerous world out there, folks. Not helped by poor decision-making skills. It's like, one of them died. It's all right. We got replacements.
Always have a backup. Oof.
Now that's fertility.
Stamina. Yeah. I'm fairly convinced that my grandmother was a nurse for the Nazis in World War II, but I can't prove that.
I get the timeline right. Ah, he was a roadie. Ah, I see. Nice.
I feel that life. Comes with the territory.
You came by it honest, is what you're saying.
Oh, sorry, I was muted for the stream. My bad, guys.
Idiot.
Really?
Yeah, I have to do a separate like mute button through OBS.
So like this whole time you've been muted?
No, not the whole time.
Oh, okay.
Just for the last couple minutes.
Oh, okay, I was gonna say, because that's a confusing
show.
So
you guys were reacting to me saying some shit. Everything I just said, nobody else heard except for you two.
Yeah. Well, there we go.
Yeah, I think they lost Jables around when he was talking about how his uncle died.
Yeah, fair.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that'd be it. Yeah. My uncle died playing with a chemistry set.
Yep.
Blew himself up in the basement. Didn't know the experiment he was doing.
And the rest you'll just have to leave to your imagination.
Yeah.
You can fill in the blanks.
Yeah, I made some jokes there. But can't really do that again.
Yeah.
They were even funny.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I chuckled at a couple of them.
Yeah. God damn. See, this is why I don't do production, guys. Blame Rimshoe.
Obviously. Blame Canada. Wait, wrong thing.
Nate.
Yeah, no. Blame.
Yeah, no, I was surprised too, Crab.
I don't appreciate that.
I'm sorry. I gotta throw in a jab when I can.
Go fuck your mother.
Right? And you're not wrong, Skull. Jables is infinitely more funny than Crab.
Yeah, that's not
even
a contest.
I don't even understand what a joke is.
Yeah.
Crap, you tried to make a joke once and you just said something racist and thought that was a joke. <That's>...
I mean, I suppose in context, maybe.
Even in context, he just said black people weren't people.
Yeah, not funny.
It's funny to make fun of him for it.
Yeah. But at least you tried, Crab. At least you tried.
I appreciate the attempt and the amount of laughter I've gotten out of making fun of you for it.
Yeah, it's like Crab can be funny, but it's never by intention.
Right? <Yeah. laughs> But now, to be fair, I don't want to make Crab feel bad. You are a good person, and I do like you. And I never want you to, you know,
let's not
hurt
be too
yourself.
Charitable.
Yeah, but the amount of times when you've gotten a whole room to laugh and you just ask, "What did I say?" is astounding.
It's true. I don't want to bully Crab.
I'll bully Crab all the time. Fuck you, Crab.
Yeah. Crab brings it on himself.
Yeah. You come to the right little whorehouse.
Here, I'll do this for you, Crab.
Fuck you, Jables.
There we go.
That one will always resonate with me.
Yeah.
All is right with the world.
I'm so... Yeah, Crab, if your mom says you're funny, then,
go fuck your mother!
Yeah, of course your mom says that you're funny, Crab. She's your mom. She has pity for you. I don't.
I bet your mom said you were handsome, too.
We all know that's a lie.
I'm joking. I'm legitimately joking. That was mean.
Yeah, I've seen worse.
Hey, do you guys want to hear this clip of Donald Duck saying the N-word?
No.
God.
I mean, yes, but probably not now.
I'll do it after the show. Crap. You have to believe in incest. It definitely exists.
It's true. It's a real thing. At least that's what Pornhub tells me. It's the most popular search on there, I think.
That's all step shit.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which, by the way, my theory about that is that when divorce became more like socially acceptable, is about the time that it's about the time that those kids ended up becoming adults.
Yeah.
So the stepmother, stepsister, stepdad, all that shit, now they're adults, and that's why porn is being made for the whole step-sibling and step-parents thing.
But that's... Now, that assumes that this has been a fantasy for all of those people for a while.
Somebody's gotten a hot stepmom, dude.
No, absolutely.
Or a hot stepsister.
I mean, I'm not above it.
Or a hot stepdad. You know. Somebody... There's been enough socially acceptable divorce that enough people have thought about it, and that's why it's so prevalent in porn now. That's what I'm getting at.
See, what I'm looking forward to is now that, we're getting... It's been a trend long enough that soon enough, the hot stepdaughter is going to eventually become the hot stepmom.
There actually is a porn actress that did that.
See?
She did stepsister, stepdaughter, and stepmom within, like, a 5 to 6 year period.
See, this is a thing.
Yeah.
It's like a create work program. I love it.
Yeah.
That's longevity, god damn it.
Yeah, so... You know, maybe porn stars can have longer careers now. You go, girls. Have you guys heard about the the mother-daughter OnlyFans?
No, but I want to.
It's just moms and daughters showing off their tits together.
Fuck yeah.
Maybe.
I mean, I'm not against it.
Seems
like I
weird.
Like tits, and I don't care if it's on a mom or a daughter, or both. I just like tits.
I mean, depending we did that age. Story where we covered that OnlyFans that the dude made with his dad.
Yes. Yeah, that was fun. Oh, man. And in a few years, it's going to be OnlyFans with 3 generations of women.
Yes.
I don't like that.
That's nah, what a world we live in. See, I'm of that age where cougars are just chicks I went to high school with, so
yeah.
Yeah, but this is what tends to happen when you have a bunch of people that got knocked up in their fucking teens.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, it's the slutty ones that'll be starting the OnlyFans, so of course it's going to be young grandma, young mom. Not to slut shame, go ahead and fuck.
Fuck yeah.
Like, when you've got women becoming grandmothers in their fucking 40s, it's just like, ugh.
No, when you have... When you're a grandmother to an 18-year-old and you're in your mid to late 40s.
Yeah.
Yeah. think we did an article about that where, like, it's like a 30-year-old grandma. Because she had her kid when she was 16, and then her kid got pregnant at, like, 15.
Mm. Mm. I have friends that are grandparents.
Yeah, I have friends that are grandparents, too. I hang out in dive bars with the old drunks.
Well, yeah, but those old drunks are probably my age. Uh-huh. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, they're definitely your age.
See?
Different world. So yeah, you know, this didn't go too badly.
No, I kind of like it. I don't like doing the production part of it, but it's been a nice, chill episode. Good conversations.
Yeah. Don't have Rimchi's dyslexic ass fucking anything up.
Yeah. God damn, that motherfucker needs to learn how to read.
I know, right? I mean, you think you'd get the hang of it after 32 years, but I guess it wasn't enough.
Yeah. Yeah, sorry for the quality of the video on the stream, guys. It's, I forgot how to change that, so that's my bad.
It's okay, it's a pity to stream real loud.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. So, like, no one's actually looking at the screen.
Nah, yeah. They're just here to listen to your beautiful voice, Jables.
Oh, that's sweet of you. But you're lying.
Yeah, see. Yeah, I know.
Yeah, everybody knows that I have the best voice here.
It's absolutely true.
Yeah, that's fair.
Good night, Skull.
Night, Skull.
Have a good one, Skull.
Hey, Nick. Best voice is my ass, Nick.
Yeah, well, Nick, just, yeah, text me when you're starting.
I know, I agree that Nick's got a very good voice to him.
He does. No question.
Yeah, is, I mean, like, have you listened?
It's not quite undoomed tier, but
well,
very few people.
That's a whole other level.
Yeah, but Nick also has like a certain flair to his voice. Have you listened to any of his narrations for Chilling Tales in the Dark?
No, I haven't gotten around to it. I really
they're great. You really should. They're good.
Yeah, I've been able to listen to a couple.
Someone is dead to me now.
Yeah, the problem that I have with Chilling Tales in the Dark is that they don't list who's narrating it.
Yeah. Actually, I noticed that.
It's a
that.
Huge fucking problem that I have.
Yeah, that does seem suspect to me. Nick says that they do. Apparently you're just a fuck up, Jables.
Where do they list that, Nick?
I've had a hard time finding it too.
Yeah.
Oh, well, that means we have to look at the screen. Jesus, Nick.
Yeah, include it. Okay, I have screen. So to find ones that you've narrated, I have to click on every single one and see which one it is.
Well, now, okay. To be fair, that's a pretty smart marketing tactic.
I mean, it does get the clicks.
Yeah, let's rethink this here.
No, because I'm not going to play that game.
Oh, here we go. Nick's getting a bus. Okay, Nick's trying to get a bus.
That's a good size bus.
It's a hell of a good bus.
Yeah, everybody go donate to Nick's GoFundMe.
Fucking international.
Yeah, it's the same one he was looking at buying at the beginning of the summer.
Yeah, I love that it came back.
It literally just looks like a decommissioned school bus. I wonder if the pneumatic doors still work.
Well, no, a bus of that year doesn't actually have a pneumatic door. It's more of a bunch of like.
Oh yeah, it would have been one of those.
It's a lever
thing. Yeah, one of the lever ones. It kind of works like a crank.
Yeah.
And I believe the ass end of that has been converted as a toy hauler.
Yeah.
So you can actually park inside of it.
Yeah, it's made so that you can park like motorcycles and stuff in the back.
Yeah, which
it has a ramp and everything.
Pretty brilliant.
Hey, Larry.
Hey, Larry.
Have you been practicing?
Nah, that son of a bitch has been playing Final Fantasy.
Yeah, that's what I was seeing. That's why I'm calling him out.
Mm-hmm. Right.
A bit. You dumb.
I mean, I'm still going to vote on Larry. I'm just saying.
I don't like the lack of support.
Nah, I mean,
hey,
I'm
fucking backing Jables on this one.
No. I always go for the underdog.
I mean, Rimshi's a
traitor. That's a really backhanded way of skirting around that, dude.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, like,
we'll see.
Rimshi's a traitorous fuck that's going to back Larry, but you know, Rimshi's not here, and there's a good reason for that.
Larry, you literally just told me you finished easy mode.
Yeah. Oh, you got 50 COEC on Mario Kart 64. Congratulations, you've completed Baby's first racing game.
Yeah. You can beat 50 CC with fucking Toad, and he has the worst speed, just good acceleration.
Oh, we're practicing. Well, nice to know that you're pacing yourself, buddy. There, Larry.
Buddy, sweet, sweet little cherub baby child. I've already gotten gold on every course in every single speed and mirror. Fuck you. I'm just doing time trials to make sure I can go faster.
What part of gold in all speed tiers, all courses, and mirrored did you miss, Larry?
Yeah, you're calling my ass slow. I'm sorry. I haven't even been playing with Yoshi and I got gold on everything. So, because I'm getting ready for that race. I've been playing as Peach.
And Larry here putting around the course at like 20 miles an hour or less.
Just being Yoshi.
I don't know.
Let me check. Let me look at my calendar. Don't want to do it Thanksgiving weekend. Well, I'm down to do it Thanksgiving weekend, but I know other people are going to be involved with their families and whatnot.
Yeah, I might not be available for that.
Let's do it.
And again, I have no idea what my schedule is going to be.
Oh, no. No, Larry. It's not about me being busy. It's about me being able to afford the nice bottle of champagne I'm going to pop when I beat your ass.
Mm-hmm.
Ugh.
Also, we still have to make sure that we have it set up so that the footage can be recorded so that we can get Canuck and, was it Vimper or Shanma to do the color commentary?
I don't know. Doesn't matter. We'll work it out.
Is Canuck still here?
No, he dipped out.
Damn it. He didn't even say goodbye, bastard.
He's back now.
Yeah, Jesus.
Larry, we'll figure out a date. It'll be sometime in December, probably.
Yeah, Cinder sounds fine.
Yeah, that's also why I think we should wait until December, so that, because they're working on fixing the lag and shit.
Be a nice way to cap off the year.
Yeah. Alright. Well, thank you everybody for joining us.
Yeah.
It's been a nice little show.
And thanks for having me.
Yeah.
Thanks for showing up.
Now I need to remember how to raid.
Please stand by.
Alright, everybody. I'll see you over on the other channel. Have a good one.
Oh, poor Larry's all fucked up. Time change.
Oh, bye, everybody.
Well, sorry, I forgot there's a slight delay. Yeah, right now. Bye. Fuck you guys.